Like right now, it just looks like we're about to fly into a hill.
We are. Hopefully we don't do it in the wrong way, though.
What's up, dude?
What's up, man?
What you doing?
Just hoofing around a heavy plane with low tire pressure.
Got to air down those tires because who knows where we're going to land today.
That's half the suspension too, so.
What's going on, everyone? Back with another episode of Stuff and Things. I'm here with an internet friend, now real life friend, Trent Palmer. What's up, dude?
What's up?
I was introduced to his videos. He's a fellow YouTube content creator and he flies planes and does all sorts of super rad stuff. My friend Will introduced me to his channel and we binged all of your videos. So I hit him up on Instagram. I was like, hey man, I'm coming through the area. Do you want to hang out? And first of all, thanks for accommodating me.
I've seen your stuff. So I was like, yes.
We do cool stuff. Yeah. Like, it's hard to deny that. So we're going to go fly today. You got some other stuff, which you guys will see later on. I don't even want to spoil the surprises.
No, we're going to try to get ourselves into some trouble today somewhere.
Trouble? We're about to go fly in a plane. So I've never flown in a plane like this before. This is the Freedom Fox, as people know it on your channel.
It is.
Can you give us a quick rundown?
So it's a Kit Fox. It started as a standard Series 5 Kit Fox. Since then, I put a bigger wing on it, bigger landing gear. Basically, I've built it into more of a bush plane versus just a standard fun little like backcountry capable plane.
So we got enough room in here for you and myself.
That's it.
And that's it. I'm excited, man. I've never been in a plane this small. I've only flown, obviously, commercial, and like, this is gonna be a new experience for me.
This thing's turbocharged, isn't it?
Yeah, turbo fuel injected, and this engine is FADEC, so it's what, full authority dedicated engine control. So it's like the smartest engine that they make in a small plane like this.
That makes me feel pretty confident. Not that I've had any like issues with flying. I'm not really nervous at all, but.
I've had an engine quit.
Yeah?
Yep.
This can glide down though, right?
The joke with the Kit Fox is if your engine quits and you're wondering where you're gonna land, throw your keys out the window and wherever they hit, that's where you're landing.
Oh God.
So it doesn't glide like that well.
All right, but well.
Getting into the plane.
Getting into the plane. You're gonna wanna put your right or left hand on the center console here.
Okay.
And then right hand up there. And basically stand on the tire, swing your butt in first.
Okay.
And leave your legs out. And sit all the way in there.
Okay, that's not too bad. Now just lift my leg up over
exactly.
There. Luckily I'm short. Well not short, but I'm like 5'10", 5'11", so
a little shorter than you.
Yeah.
All right.
Sweet.
We're in.
You nervous at all?
A little bit maybe now that I'm sitting here, but still have confidence in you.
Well, I hope so.
I've seen you fly so many times, so.
So this engine is kind of interesting to start. It's got dual alternators. One is specifically for engine power.
Okay.
So when the engine's not running, it's not making power. So I have this momentary switch that pulls power off the battery. So I have to hold that, and then for cold start, it wants to be between 50 and 70% throttle. And then I'll flip on a fuel pump, wait for fuel pressure to come alive. Then I'll just say clear, go. Clear!
Reno-Stead Airport. Automated weather observation, 1, 5, 3, 3, Zulu. Wind, calm, visibility, 6.
So you just make that adjustment as they call that out?
Yeah, I already set it for field, so it was pretty close. That's just the altimeter setting. So basically, you know, it's using air pressure to see how high we are above sea level. You'll notice that we're a little blind in here as far as seeing in front of us, which is why I have the little front view camera.
Oh, I was wondering what that was. So that's a little camera in between the wheels.
It's so I can see what's right in front of me so I don't shred another prop, which I have done. The traffic, Freedom Fox taking runway 8 will be a left crosswind turnout northbound instead. So we'll just line up on the runway.
Cool.
Get up to full throttle, lift the tail, and then right about there we'll fly.
He just took off in like 50 feet.
That was probably 200.
Was it? It seemed way quicker.
Oh, you got a vent right here, so if you get hot, that's what you open, or sick, which hopefully I won't make you sick. The traffic, Freedom Fox, left crosswind for 8 will be northbound stick. So and then my house is right there, so for landing I'm obviously high, but you would set up for the runway kind of this way.
Your wife's waving.
Hey, that's funny. So this guy's the throttle that you see me twisting.
Yep.
Basically for big adjustments, like that's gonna be more throttle, that's gonna be less throttle. So push in to go faster. As far as the other controls, the stick is gonna be the attitude of the airplane. So if I push right, it rolls the plane right. Push left, it goes left. If I pull back, it goes up. Push the nose down, plays forward. And then the rudder is basically like brakes of the yaw axis. So if I just go like that, see how it turns the plane sideways?
Yep.
And then the left one goes that way.
Okay.
So to do a turn, it's kind of a coordinated action of like doing some rudder and a little bit of the aileron and then pulling back. Because if you just turn sideways, the plane will just slide down. So
yeah,
and I'll let you try flying it after, maybe after this next spot.
Okay.
So this one is called Rocky Meadow. It's obviously a bit of an uphill meadow, and there's just rock sporadic throughout it. So I was the first one to land here, and the first time it was kind of scary because you don't know where the rocks are now. So many people come in here that we have all these tracks, it makes it really easy.
Yeah.
It's not really a go around, so if you screw up your landing, like figure it out, because you can't fly out of it. So it's not like a full beginner spot, but because it's so long and it's relatively smooth, it's pretty easy most of the time.
Yeah.
Felt smooth to me.
I've had commercial landings that felt worse than that.
Thanks, man. So then also, because it looks like my right wing tank's a little lower fuel-wise than my left, I'm going to park so that it's going to cross-feed. So
okay.
I'm going to park facing the opposite way I normally would.
Cool.
Then I'll let that turbo cool for 1 second, and then we'll be done. And I got to pee, so we're jumping out.
Cool.
All right, first flight in the Freedom Fox. You're gonna make me want to buy one of these, dude.
Dude, we're just getting started.
How much is one of these cost, if you don't mind me asking?
So, they vary because they have so many different models. Like the early first like three versions of the Kit Fox are all, they're like an ultralight. They run a little two-stroke snowmobile engine.
Yeah.
So those can be had really cheap, but I wouldn't really recommend one of those. The Model 4, which is the one before mine, you can still get with a good engine for like 30 grand.
Okay.
But if you wanted a brand new one with the biggest engine and all built out, like say you're building my plane, but the current model brand new, would probably be 140,000.
So it obviously depends on the options.
Yeah.
A lot of people ask me questions like that about the van all the time. They're like, oh, how much does a rig like that cost? And the answer varies so much because it's like you can buy a fully kitted out van exactly how you want it through like a boutique retailer and it could be upwards of 150.
Oh, easy.
Or you could buy a pre-built out van like mine, pay maybe 100. People are paying like 150 now, which is just absurd. So it's really cool to see like a plane and how you put your own spin on it.
Yeah. I mean, for reference too, I mean, just this engine is like $40,000.
Okay.
So, and for what I do and where I fly, it's worth it.
Yeah.
Up here, high altitude, trying to, you know, be as high performance as possible. But if you're flying at sea level or you don't care about getting off the ultimate shortest, you can save 20 grand on that engine alone and go with the brand new lower version. Or if you got a used version of it, you could save 30 grand right there and then, you know, it's across the board. There's cheap and effective ways to do it that, like, if you're on a budget, it's totally doable.
That's another thing that I get too. I'm sure you get comments like this. We've been talking shop about like YouTube and social media nonstop, but I always get the comments like, oh yeah, it's a cool van, but that's not even worth it. It's like, yeah, man, maybe to you.
Yeah, to each,
like,
one's own, man.
Yeah. I'm sure there are pilots out there who see this plane, they're like, oh, that's Gucci or whatever, like, I don't need all that stuff. And you're right.
Yeah.
You built it for yourself, and that's what I find super cool about things like that.
Yeah, and honestly, for reference, the Carbon Cub for a long time, it's a Super Cub variant that's a new version that's lightweight. It's kind of the gold standard when it comes to like nice backcountry aircraft. And for one that performs like mine, you're gonna spend $300,000 on a Carbon Cub. So this is like actually the good, you know, better value version of that. But
cool.
It all, you know, again, different strokes for different folks.
So yeah, with like landing a place like this, our etiquette or the code is, you know, you do a multiple passes before you just land somewhere.
Yeah.
So I had inspected it a bunch. And then once you land there, just stop. Don't even taxi to where you think your takeoff is. Don't taxi at all. You just get out, walk it, figure out where all your stuff is, and then you can taxi. So that's what I did here, was just figured out where all the crap was,
yep.
And then I could taxi and line up and all that.
So you don't use a camera for this?
No. I don't use it for takeoff, just taxi.
Okay.
Woo! Used a little ski jump there. Oh, you know what? Maybe I should take you to Goats. Goats is a, there's a little knoll over here I can land on. That's kind of cool because you can look all directions and it's a sportier landing than most places. You can kind of see this one little valley in front of us.
Yep.
Just in the like sight picture of that valley, there's a little knoll that's just past it. It's not up to the horizon, but that knoll, I call the place Goats because first time I landed there, there was those speed goats antelope. They were all over it, so that's the spot. But it's a really cool one because it's like a turning side hill, uphill landing that you have to peek up onto. Like you land on the right knoll and go up to the left one.
Okay. Yeah, see, I would not know where to land here.
I take pilots that do not know where to land here, so. This is kind of my little, I was creative one day and was like, I think I could land going side hill, uphill, roll on this thing here, and did it, and it worked.
Like right now, it just looks like we're about to fly into a hill.
We are. Hopefully we don't do it in the wrong way, though. So that's Goats.
Dang, man, you gotta have some balls to do that the first time. Holy sh**. From the air, I would not think you could land there.
Yeah. So, I don't think we need to get out. Let's just blast off to the next spot, huh?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, I'm gonna ski jump it off that guy. So, we're gonna just drive it down this hill. And once we get to the bump, pull it off.
Woo! That's a fun one.
That is a fun one, huh?
I feel like you can land this thing anywhere.
You can land anywhere once. Yeah. It's taken back off that you gotta worry about right. If you can use the plane again, but. We are working our way into State Line Meadow is what I called it. I don't know what the actual name is. We just like, we have this thing, if you land somewhere first, you get to name it.
Okay.
So I landed here first, so I just named it State Line Meadow, and I'll show you why. We'll jump out at this one, it's kind of cool. And then there's a really rad canyon to run over there.
Spot number three, technically.
Three, second we're getting out at.
State Line?
State Line Meadow.
So why is this called State Line? Are we gonna be able to find out here?
Yes. But basically, that's State Line Peak up there.
Okay.
So that was why I originally called it that.
Trent was explaining that when you're a pilot like he is and you're landing in these spots for the first time, you get to name them. So we've been to three different places now that you've named.
Oh yeah.
Bagging and tagging.
So you can see Nevada painted on that rock right there. Currently, standing in California, you are standing in the land of freedom.
I am.
I'm gonna come join you.
Yes.
America.
Doesn't it feel liberating?
It does, it feels great. The Freedom Fox, we might have to move it over to the left a little bit. So this landing in the last, or two landings ago, when we were at the rock meadow, It's rocky. That's not a good example of a rock, but the tire pressure that you were explaining, They're not normal tires.
No, and I'll show you them when we get over there, but these tires are designed to be ran at almost no pressure at all, and they're built so that you can land with the brakes locked. They don't spin and shear a valve stem or, you know, throw a bead or anything like that. They're pretty impressive the way that they're made.
It's pretty much like a inner tube just fixed to the wheel or the rim.
Yeah, it is, and that's what it is. They call it an integrated tire tube. So it's basically an inner tube that's wrapped in a couple layers of Kevlar and thicker rubber. And they use a thinner or softer ply rubber, so it's really malleable. It'll roll over anything. And it grips to, like, for what we have with no tread, it grips really well.
Right.
So they're pretty cool tires, and they're, for how soft and, you know, cush they can be, they're really resilient to landing on sharp rocks and stuff.
We are entering my favorite canyon to fly.
All right. I've probably seen this one on videos.
Actually just now when I did the that toolkit one that you said you saw.
Yep.
This was the canyon.
Cool.
Woo. There's a spring right here, which is kind of rad. You see it's totally dry and then all of a sudden there's a creek out of it. The boat there? Our boat. Cool thing about this canyon, it's so steep, we're basically just gliding down it right now. I'm barely above idle.
Ew. It's so sick. Yeah. This thing can take more force than I thought.
Oh, we probably did a G and a half. It can handle four.
Dang.
All right. So put your feet on the rudder pedals.
Yep.
Good. And put your right hand on the stick. we're gonna see if you can fly this thing. So normally what I like to do is just let you feel out what the controls do. So why don't you push on the stick to the right and see how it rolls the plane to the right. There you go. Pull it back the other way. Goes left. And you can give it a little more than that. You don't have to be too, you know, gentle. Okay. Pull the nose up by pulling the stick back. There you go. Okay. Push it forward to go back down. And then for the rudders, I'll show you what those do. They work like brakes. So if you want to slow the right wing down, you push the right rudder. So go ahead, push on the right rudder.
Okay.
To keep the plane level so you can feel what that does. What that does is puts the plane out of coordination. We're basically skidding through a turn right here.
Okay.
You can see on this little ball. So I'm going to ride along with you, but the first one, let's just make you make a turn towards that flat mesa over there.
Okay.
So what you'll do is start with a little rudder, then push right stick, and then you're going to have to pull a little bit of back pressure so we don't slide out of the sky.
Okay.
So start with a little right rudder,
little right stick,
and then go ahead and pull back a little bit.
Up a little bit.
That was a textbook.
Woo!
Yeah, that was like you've done this before.
I'm the captain now.
You are. Let's take another one back to the left. Left is going to give you a different sight picture because it puts you higher over the cowling, so we'll see if you climb or descend.
But okay. Try to keep it level.
Ooh.
That was a nice, like, decent, rate, steep turn. That was a standard 30-degree turn.
Dude, you're flying.
Woo!
Sweet. I'm going to take a nap. Tell me when we're there.
So is this the wind pushing us right now? Because I'm having to...
So when you're climbing and we're under more power, the swirl off the prop, it's called P-factor, pushes on the right side of the rudder and pushes the plane, left side, it pushes the plane left. So you have to hold right rudder when you're climbing.
Okay. Yeah, because I feel that just now. We're at 7. Oh, go down a little bit. 7,000.
Dude, again, I think private pilot check ride is going to tell you within 100 feet. I think they give you plus or minus, so you didn't go over the 100, you'd still be passing a check ride right now.
Cool.
And like, just so you know, I haven't touched any of the controls in a while. This is all you.
This is so cool, man. I did not think I was going to ever fly a plane, let alone do it today.
Oh yeah.
So I have officially flown a plane now. That was never really anything like on my bucket list before, but
I just always assume if you jump in my plane, you're expecting to fly it.
I was literally not expecting that, but I'm glad to say that I've flown a plane now. Hopefully it's not the last time that I fly one either.
Dude, you killed it.
Thank you. Yeah. Add that to my resume, I guess. So enough of the plane stuff.
You've got a tool in your pocket that I'm sure people want to know about.
The Skeletool?
Yeah, dude. So my other friend Mike carries one, swears by it, had one for like 6 years.
Yeah.
And it seems like you do too. What do you do with that to the plane?
I have always carried at least a knife like you do. And I thought you were going to make fun of me for this. That's the funniest part. I was like, oh, he probably hates multi-tools. But
part of me wants to hate the Skeletool, but I think it's just too good. I still don't own one, but...
Dude, I use it every single day. Like I said, with the plane, the screwdriver, just checking the oil. There's a little oil access cover every single day with this. Obviously, opening packages. I can't tell you how often you use pliers. Like when you have them, there's things that you probably don't even notice that you like... You'd fix it if you had pliers, or you would grab it with pliers, but you just, because you don't have it, you don't think about it. So, dude, I swear by these things. I'm telling you, I feel naked without it. Worse than my phone.
So my shopping list is growing. I'm going to add a bush plane to it and a Skeletool. I'll probably get the Skeletool before I get a plane.
I can see why.
All right, guys, so we're back from the flight. Trent is doing, what is this called, like an after-flight inspection?
Yeah, I'm just checking the oil.
Oh, checking the oil, that's it?
Yeah, but when it's warm, it's easier to burp it. This thing's going to make a little gurgling noise.
Okay.
Hear it?
So maintenance is pretty low then.
Yeah, as long as you stay on top of it, you know, unforeseen things can happen, but...
Just like anything else, car, motorcycle, or whatever.
Yeah, there's wear and tear items. There's other ones that are just like pretty bulletproof. There's not that many moving parts on an airplane, honestly. I think like a car with transmission, drive shafts, all the... So many moving parts. This, it's really just the propeller and then your wheels and brakes.
Sweet.
So it's still pretty early in the morning, I guess. It's not even noon yet. And we have a full day ahead of us. I was gonna make this all one giant collab video of us just doing rad stuff, but we're going to break it up. So if you want to check out what we're doing, make sure you consider clicking subscribe and make new videos every week. We got a lot of cool stuff. He's also filming a video over on his channel, so of course check that out up in the corner right up there. And anything else you want people to know?
No.
That's it.
Man, this is fun. Watch the next video too.
Yeah, because we're about to go have more fun than I'm even ready for.
I hope.
Thanks for having me, dude.
Hell yeah.
I will talk to you guys in the next one.